many, many, many questions. So we have our two speakers, right, our friends who might be willing to whatever they need to do. So please have at it. And this is your last day. You have less than 24 hours to repent. You can. Donna.
This question is for Angus. And so your use of different texts allowed me to understand that Nipah came into language much earlier than it had been previously suspected. So my question is actually on Nipah, because you showed it existed in the earlier centuries.
Right.
And it still does exist, but there's been significant change in the meaning, and I'm wondering if you have documented that in any way.
I haven't really looked into the details. As you all probably know, old forms never die. You know, they just become relics. And in fact, you know, "nu alone" is still widely used in phrases like "you should have said why" and things like that. But there actually was somebody else who antedated the Avadaptana even further back. There's an amazing document which I found, I managed to get it for like 30 bucks. It's a German reproduction of a of the journal of Jean Herolat, who was the personal physician to King Louis XIII, from his birth in like 1600, I think, through to Herolat's death in like 1620 or something like that. And he kept in obsessively detailed notes. I mean, that was his only job, right? Everything that the king, you know, ate, drank, chat, you know, every like medicine and suppository that he gave to him, things like that, but also everything that he heard the king say. And King Louis XIII, when he was like 6 years old, actually did say, "No fait pas ça," or something like that, to his, you know, nurses and governesses and things like that. So we do have earlier versions of that. But in terms of Nipah, I haven't really documented that. I mean, I haven't really looked into it, but the frequencies are essentially, you know, there does seem to be kind of a heyday in the 17th and 18th centuries, and then it reduces.
I have a general question.
Yes.
And you mentioned taking your research into other genres. So I am remembering when the British National Corpus was first built and how laboriously people endeavored to make it representative and argue over what representative meant and what percentage of it should be ephemera and what percent of it should be high-level academic texts and everything in between, right? And so your two examples of how different corpora can give you completely different results depending on your build is really instructive. I think it's just useful to remember, for instance, that because the Colville Dictionary was so built on newspaper corpus that their frequency statistics were skewed because they gave quite, you know, a dime. It's a really important word for learners of English to know because they happen to be the slice of newspaper corpus that they had during the First World War. So there's a connection there, I think, also to Merriam's vast holdings in citations, because citations are, by their nature, looking for things that are unusual rather than typical. And but I do think that there's an effort, isn't there, John, in the reading and marketing program to find some kind of representativeness across genres. So can you guys both, I know this is a terrible long way to get to the question, but each of you speak to the challenges and importance of representativeness.
Well, let me just complicate it a little further, which is, I think the other thing is complicate it a little further, saying I think it's not that we're necessarily always looking for. It's not that we're necessarily looking for different or representative. Very often in the citation collection, what you're looking for is useful. When you're trying to wrestle through BMUs, or another one I'll later in that one was litany and how the meanings of litany change, you don't just want a whole bunch of random examples of litany. You don't necessarily want representative, I don't necessarily want different, I want citations that illustrate the author's meaning well, which we can detect what is being meant by that word. Things are a little different. The kind of define that I tend to talk about is when we're trying to say semantic content of words, as opposed to what you were talking about, which is collocations of words. So that's why I want to overcomplicate this a little bit to add that there. I would be particularly wanting to see us get good citations that reveal the meaning well. And then kind of the chips fall. Because in the end, we're not trying to tell you which sentence you use is most common. That's not really our job. Our job is just to try to lay out the limits of what we use category and what doesn't mean.
Yeah, no, I think that's an excellent point. Representativeness is a tool. It's about what is useful. And my focus on representativeness was again going back to linguistic theories, and the specific linguistic theory I was working from was this idea of type frequency. If you hear a word in a certain variety of contexts, the wider the variety of contexts you hear it in, the more likely you are to use it in new contexts because it seems like this very versatile word, right? And so in order to do that, you have to look at what people were exposed to back then, which leads to a question, okay, well, how do you know what people were exposed to, right? And it's sort of a similar thing if you're talking about learner dictionaries like Cogill. What is the learner trying to learn, you know? Are they trying to learn what an average speaker of English anywhere in the English-speaking world knows? Are they trying to learn what a native speaker knows, or what what somebody who's slightly more upper class knows, who speaks some not particularly stigmatized variety, is exposed to those kinds of things, and then all those kinds of things play into that, right? And similarly with the going back to the Faisal that says, their target audience was non cultivé, this cultivated man who wanted to know, who was interested in specifically what the literary, the more upper class authors were doing, right? Because they wanted to write things that were kind of at that level, right? But going back to these kind of functionalist linguistic theories, which was the framework that I was in, I just wanted to know, okay, if you have, let's say, a playwright like maybe somebody who's not a fancy playwright, somebody like Sylvain, what is Sylvain exposed to? What is he thinking about when he's sitting down to write his play? Right? Does he go around listening to servants or something like that? And so all those things kind of play into it.
Let me just make your point for you on one question. I think we do find ourselves talking about frequency, and that is on styling compounds. Whether something should be an open compound, a hyphenated compound, or a closed compound. And this is something that the copy editors are acutely aware of and bug us constantly about. And because we have discrepancies between in the current collegiate. What you tend to see in the current collegiate, and not just us talking, other colleges up at this 6 years ago, including budgets from the world, which is probably other copy of music. There's a real tendency to get those compounds closed. So as soon as there's some citations for closed compounds, there's a tendency to close them. And I think there is a good example that I think we as people who need to mark, notice the closed compounds are marking it disproportionately to the occurrences of the open compound. And as we are blending the sources that we look at to make those calls, what we're realizing is the fact that old unabridged may actually reflect general use of compounding more than the more current dictionaries, which maybe kind of jumped the gun in terms of closing up words that in fact aren't always as close up as we might think they are. So I think we did, at least on that particular issue, I think we did exactly what you were suggesting, is we noted differences and we sort of loaded up the files with more examples of difference and not enough what's actually represented. I think we do fall prey to it, but I think that's, and I think it's a heresy because you know people say, you know how you could want to, you would set hurry to close up your database and not have a data space base? You almost look like you're the old folk who doesn't want to change, because I think you're actually diving into the data, it turns out that you didn't change as fast as you did.
Who has not asked a question? I haven't asked a question, but now I have to go ahead. Just a quick one to follow up what you just said. So this example might also be email hyphenated versus email closed. And I find this issue very interesting in internet age because my company, Mark, sells email editing training services. And I had to cross over as an editorial type about 10 years ago to participate in commerce on the internet because if we're searching on closed email, and I wanted to write open for the hyphen. And that forced me to change more quickly. So when you say you can be jumping the gun, there are societal forces at work that really influence the speed.
We certainly struggled with email for a long time. Data problem, remember the editorial history is really blank now, but certainly people who used email a lot, who were in the business of email, will close it up faster. Wall Street Journal is going to close it up a lot more slowly. But you know, the Brooklyn Advertiser Gazette may not be. So if you look at a bigger sort of collection, you may find that the old style, heaven knows you might see capital D might out there. The old styles persist more than necessarily more paper. But I understand that within subgenres, if you're in the business, and we see this in there, you've got lots of people who are in that digital business, and they want to see their digital vocabulary reflected in the dictionary.
That wasn't my real question. That's
kind of. But can I just also jump in on this, which is that this also fits in with another of Bybee's theories, which it's not just hers, but it's an observation that goes back probably almost 100 years, which is the effect of high frequency that tends to reduce things not only in speech but also in writing, so that forms the more frequently a form is used, the more likely it is to be reduced in speech, and the more likely it is to be, you know, written as one word, or you know, maybe with an intermediate stage of hyphenation. And then, you know, and you can even see this at a fine grade level, as you were talking about, where you have different groups of people who use it at different frequencies, and so who reduce it to different degrees. But also, I think that's an interesting thing with the difference between the unabridged and the collegiate, is that, you know, you can see that the ones that were used earlier tend to, you know, basically, if you look at it from an earlier time frame, they were probably the data show less and closing, as you said. So there's a whole bunch of interesting stuff with that, and stuff that, you know, that can be that's actually in the theater course as well.
We have a question from Michael. Would you please
you've seen.
Play Margaret just recently the new noir. And very sort of quite going along in some interesting way. Then all of a sudden, and then throughout, many, many, many forward words. And this struck me, I didn't think, oh, the playwright was trying to modernize. Lost, but then more, I thought about it, I said, no, it's because that's how people talk. So what do you do with words like that, that kind of cultural blanking out certain words even though they exist in the culture? What do you do with that, the frequency, the representation, and the number of books? Because if you do those 31 plays, they had zero. You had zero efforts.
I don't remember any.
The people who were living and writing and treading those plays use them every day.
Yeah, no, that's
all I can say is to some degree that, first of all, it's an unusual question. You're not trying to really go to stuff that maybe you don't have to date with that, what you're talking about. But think leaf that I think this mainstream lexicographers have said is that fundamentally, not exclusively, fundamentally, we're recording the written language. But it is so hard to get on date. Certainly, it's hard to get on date without what's the spoken language. So just by necessity, we record the written language. And so the F word gets into the dictionary when, in fact, mainstream publications are using it. So you start seeing it, I think, places like the Saturday Review, or don't think back to the decision in the 60s and 70s that had that word. And you start seeing that word in mainstream publications. That's the signal that dictionaries have to add. That may not be good, they should have done it, but just traditionally, that's been our way of answering this to say, we're fundamentally tracking the written language and something like that.
So there's somebody who's written on the F word.
I have a friend who knows the word for fuchsia in several different languages because he looks up fuck and if he doesn't find it,
Also, this is an example of why corpora are not the all and end all of language work, because this is an exact example where you have something that, no matter how we report this, it's not going to represent the actual language that's out there. And you have to extrapolate from negative evidence or from little evidence that you have. And this, for example, there's a great example that I quote in the F word, where there was a court case in the US in the 19th century where a man was arrested on rape charges. There was a claim made that he could say, I'm going to fuck you 100 times. I screwed her 100 times. And he lost, and then there was an appeal based on the ground that the word fuck didn't exist. We looked at a bunch of dictionaries, there's no examples of it, therefore this is not an actionable and so forth. And the judge wrote, I forget the exact passage, but something like, because the modesty of our lexicographers prevents them from including certain words, it does not follow that these are not English words well known to everyone who speaks the language. So corpus is useless in this case, but in fact we know now that in fact fuck was very widely used in the 19th century, even though it was almost never written down in things like this. So.
Can I say a bit more about it? It's important to keep in mind the context of all this. If we're looking at the Parisian stage, for example, there were censors who had to approve every play that was performed on stage in Paris. So it was interesting because there was they had different degrees of power depending on what was going on. So after the Restoration, under Louis XVIII, they had much more power than before the Restoration, even under Napoleon. And under Napoleon, they had more power than they did under the Revolution. And I don't even know what was going on with terror and things like that. But it would be interesting. I haven't gone back that far, but it would be interesting to know because, before the Revolution, there were basically only two licensed theaters in the city. And then it jumped to like 18. And so presumably somebody got away with something. So it would be interesting to kind of look. There are definitely some plays that are kind of racy, I would say, that managed to get some things past the censors. So, but yeah, it is absolutely important to keep those contexts in mind when you're dealing with published work. But there are other ways we can get around it, you know, by looking at say, letters, you know, that there are things that people would write in personal letters that they wouldn't, you know, that wouldn't get past the censors or publishers, things like that.
I would make a plea also for letters, certainly when we're doing the usage for Ward Gilman, made a point of getting a lot of citations in the plot of personal correspondence, because that does, you do see people who have not been subjected to the editing process.
Yeah, one of the reasons I chose theater was because there's been theater, we have plays in France from the present day, going all the way back to the mid-12th century. We don't have letters for the same period. On the other hand, we don't have, you know, medieval romances from the 18th century. So that's one thing. And even that varies a lot. But at least we have one genre that's sort of been around for most of that time.
So actually, one thing that I love about Derek Bickerton's work is that he worked with court transcripts, documented Hawaiian language, right? And the nice thing about court transcripts is it's true that people are kind of speaking politely, they're on their best behavior, but they it's still their natural speech. So for him, it was really about different language groups and different subcommunities. And when people are in court and testifying, they announce who they are exactly, right? So you know all this information about the speaker. But that's not my question. My question is actually about, when you talk about these being a documentation of the written word, what about decisions about syllabification? And I asked that, my daughter has these homework assignments now for fifth grade where they're learning these different words and they have to look them up in the dictionary and they have to mark the syllabification, and I was struck by how many, for example, they're learning different roots, right, roots. And they'll have all these words with neo, and sometimes there's a syllable break between the E and the O, and sometimes there isn't. And how can you know, how does that decision get made about the syllabification?
I'm officially out of my depth on that one. We have a pronunciation editor who can give you a much better explanation than I'm about. But I will tell you that, and my father is a teacher, but in that court situation, that in fact our pronunciation editor does spend a good deal of time listening to the way the language is used. Very often listening to interviews where we know who the person is. So we know whose pronunciation, where is this. And it's particularly helpful for us in scientific terms, because if you see rhizophyllum brucellosis or something, the chances that we go from personal exposure with how we pronounce it is unlikely. So getting experts who know what they're talking about, getting their pronunciations is very helpful. So part of it is just gathering evidence. I think also part of it is that there is this kind of predictability where the syllable values will be. And again, we have a pronunciation editor here who gives talks on this and does a much better job than I. But just to say there's a certain predictability around it. So by analogy, we make some of those decisions. So it's both data gathering and what phonologists go tends to happen with a word like that in English. Okay, one other thing about this one. At least in Merriam-Webster, the distinction between the end of the line division points and syllable breaks. The center dots you see in bold face forms are there to indicate where you break the word if you were doing hyphenation justification. The syllable boundaries are indicated within the pronunciation with hyphens. And sometimes they're not in the same place because just there are certain kinds of customs about how the end of line divisions that don't necessarily map to where syllable boundaries are. So make sure your daughter's looking at the hyphens of the pronunciation.
They aren't.
The
that's very interesting.
Yeah.
They aren't.
It's mean, they're usually the same, but they're not always the same. Traditions are
wrong. And they're looking at those dots.
The simple boundaries are hyperbolic conservation.
So we have time for two more questions. Or Jack, do you want to add? Okay. One last question. And then we can eat all the food.
I suppose I'll identify myself as the youngest person from here. The question I had is if there's an issue of lack of representation of like regional sign and things like that in the corpus because they aren't written down, is there a movement towards sort of analyzing social media and the fact that it does give all of those people a platform to show off the language and their sign?
Absolutely. My cousin, Jack Creek, I mean, we don't know if we're cousins, but he's been doing an amazing amount of work on analyzing Twitter, specifically geotagged tweets, and showing the distribution of various forms. And also, I think he was at one of these, but he's not here today, Taylor Jones. Has used geotag tweets to document geographic distribution of different forms within African American English that actually correspond to different streams of the Great Migration from the 60s. So yeah, there is a bunch of good work being done in that area.
One thing I would add to that is that one of the things the effect of social media is doing is making it harder to put regional tags on anything anymore. One of those, whenever we're trying to come up with examples of regionalism in the dictionary, the word spending always used to jump to mind because it was a word pretty much just used in the Pacific Northwest. Now it's a TV commercial that's using spending. So I think these words tend to more get out of their area of restrictive use. Some of those regional labels almost have to start getting the
grades. Yes, Wendy.
I gotta just say this.
Month.
Because it's really tied to what the theme was for today, right? Which is talking about what gets lost when you go and print in the galleys in the digital, right? So I was just observing as you were talking, John, that about the taking something out because on balance it didn't need to be there because it would turn a line and wasn't that important, right? So I think that the question of authority and curation is in tension now with, because I'm busily trying to promote all those run-ons that I thought weren't that important to give a full definition to in the print dictionary because space is a premium.
Right.
But now the web wants, you know, to crawl everything and have value for the folder content on the pages, and so all of a sudden, our choices of what to present to people, right? And it goes back to, well, which corpus do you get, right? We're not the authorities we once were anymore.
Right. Well, and I think it's even more nefarious than that. I think before, dictionary makers did work under the sort of the tyranny of not taking up too much space. So, if we have changes in species, do we really need family? Let's save a line and get rid of it. Now, in fact, I think the tables are turned. But in fact, you want to load up your page with stuff, even if it isn't important, because the more text you put around a head word, the more Google's going to like it, and the more likely. But we all know how we look up words in dictionaries these days. We Google the word. And we all say, whatever Google gives me is good enough for me. And if you don't know the dictionary definition, I guarantee you do with recipes or plant care or something else. We all essentially have surrendered our own ability, you know, our own discernment about sources of information. I figure Google can figure it out for us. That puts pressure on dictionary making now widely to load up an entry with too much information. So just as we used the tyranny to cut, now we use the tyranny to expand. And I think it's a problem. Because even if space isn't an issue, people's attention span has limitations. And I kind of think you still should cut that out of the name. Even if you've got all the space in the world, and even if there's pressures to add that to get rid of the movement on the paper.
request that you all can think about this for the next Metrolines New York, that you deal with plagiarism into generics. So think about that and how we can